Hi, I'm Selectman Bill McDevitt, and I'd like to welcome you to another edition of All About Town. This time we've gone out in the field. A while back we had a program where we had Paul Gagnon from the Conservation Commission, Chair of the Conservation. Paul is with me here today. And what we discussed at that sit-down was the preservation of town lands for open space. We thought we would go out and take a bit of a hike so you could see you don't have to drive to the White Mountains to have a really nice walk with your family or friends or by yourself right here in town. So we're just off Sherburn Road, and Paul, I'm going to turn this over to you, and you can talk a little bit about this particular parcel and some of the trails that are available.
All right, thanks, Bill. This parcel dates back to, I think, 2004. It was the first major acquisition that the town made after passing the $3 million bond, and it's a perfect example of what we would never have been able to do without the $3 million bond. This parcel has 110 acres on it, and it was appraised at $1.4 million. We purchased it at a bargain sale of $1 million, so one-third of the bond went to buying this parcel. After that, we bought the adjacent parcel. You can't see it in the picture, but there's a stone wall here that separates this from a 37-acre piece, which we bought, and that was purchased for about $300,000, but we used current use monies, so that had no tax implications.
Okay, that's not from property taxes.
Not from property tax. What happens when you start doing this is then you find these parcels that the town owned that were landlocked that nobody had access to, and all of a sudden become adjacent to these beautiful town forests. So the 110 acres stood by itself. When we added the 37 acres, it abutted a 25-acre piece that had been donated by a Charles Jack.
Okay.
So all of a sudden, you put it all together, you got a 175-acre conservation area, and it's the most used conservation area in town, mainly because it's right on Sherburn
Road. Right on Sherburn Road. It has a parking lot that'll hold, I don't know, 10 cars maybe?
Easy.
12 cars, 15 on a busy day. I doubt that we ever have that many cars here, but nonetheless, it's a very convenient place to just pull off. And it's marked by a green conservation sign right out there on Sherburn Road. So could you talk a little bit about this particular parcel and some trails, and then maybe we'll take some direction and guidance from you and start off on one of those trails.
Okay. This is one of my two favorite conservation areas, and mainly that's because of the diversity of habitat. This, as you can see in the map, has three major wetlands. It has beautiful uplands, and we're going to take this red trail for part of the walk and see some huge rock outcroppings and also a field that we reclaimed. This was a field that used to be mowed and hayed, and then it was let go into early succession when we bought the property. And had part of it logged, we had this field section reclaimed, and right now it's a beautiful green young field at this time of year.
So when you say early succession, you mean trees are starting to grow back?
Yeah, it was all brushy. You couldn't walk on it. It had, you know, 20, 30 foot high, small trees, and it was just completely overgrown, which is a habitat that certain animals like, but open field is really lacking in New Hampshire. It's either you've got houses with lawns, or you have wooded parcels, and there's very few open fields. So this is great habitat. In fact, the last time I was there, which was about 2 weeks ago, we saw a Tom Turkey fanning himself in that field.
Okay, okay, great.
I said this is one of my favorites. The other of my favorite, which is a little harder to get to, is the Gumpus Pond Conservation Area. It too has a great variety of habitat. It's got wetlands that are beaver created. It's got uplands. It's a little more remote than this one. So you have a tendency to see some critters that you might not see here. For example, when I was there just last Tuesday, I saw a Blanding's turtle, which is an endangered species.
Yes.
And there's a great blue heron rookery. And they're a little flighty.
Okay.
So there's a beautiful great blue heron rookery there. And this, to see a bird that stands 3 feet high, up 100 feet in a tree, standing on a bunch of twigs, is
it looks like a pterodactyl. Okay.
It's really strange, but there's a beautiful rookery there. So that's another one I would encourage people to go to, and you get there by going down Hines Lane, and there's a parking lot much like this on the right. That also has a printable trail map online and has some well-marked trail.
So, and there's a sign when you get to the parking lot, as you drive along Hines Lane, you'll find a sign.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's right. So my thought here today, if you want to hike for about an hour.
That's about right. And that's a good thing to talk about. How long does it take to hike these various trails?
Well, the hikes can be as short as 15 or 20 minutes and as long as maybe an hour and a half if you stay within this park.
Okay.
We're working to connect this to some other open space that'll eventually get you to Gumpus. And I mentioned that last Tuesday I hiked from this parking lot all the way to Gumpus and back. It took 3.5 hours.
And you never...
Never crossed the town, never crossed the paved road, and only left town land once, and we're working on making that town land.
Excellent.
So soon you'll be able to hike 3.5 hours, never cross a paved road, and never leave town land.
And what kind of a hike is this? Another, if I have little kids, or a stroller, or I've got someone who has a walking disability, it's a little more difficult, I'm going to assume.
There are trails here that you could do with a walking disability and a stroller, like this white trail, for quite a distance.
Okay.
But most of the trails are, you know, rolling hills.
They're moderate.
They're moderate.
People okay.
do a lot of mountain biking on here, so
okay.
they're adequate for that.
Yep.
But I'd say you know, and if you just had a little cane or something, I think
okay.
you could do fine.
Okay.
But they're not wheelchair accessible, for example.
But it's not certainly not hand over hand climbing
no,
or extremely tedious and difficult.
This is pretty light duty.
Okay.
This is pretty light duty climbing.
Okay. The average family could come here and have a good
Absolutely.
Good walk.
And you're not going to get lost. There's a scenic view on one end, Sherbin on the other, Mammoth on the third, and there's Green Meadow up here. So doesn't matter, if you closed your eyes and walked, you'd hit a road eventually.
Okay, it's not going to get too lost.
No, you're not going to okay. get too lost. So my proposal is we come down the Blue Trail, which will bring us to the first bridge. We take this red trail, take a couple of the boulder loops, because they're really interesting glacial erratics in that area, and stop at the field. Maybe we'll get lucky and see some turkeys
okay.
or something. We'll come back that route. We'll come follow this main wetland here, cross the second bridge, just hold until we get there, and then we'll just return through the yellow and the white trail to the parking lot. So you'll get a real good feel for what the park is like.
Terrific. Let's get started.
Okay, here we go. All right, so these are the type, well, I'm going to wait till Jim can get a picture, but these are the type trail markers.
All right, they're all marked with a blue blaze.
Yes.
And that one's got an arrow, so the blue trail obviously goes to the right,
Correct.
And the white trail to the left.
Exactly.
Okay.
We're going to take the blue trail. We'll
okay.
turn on the white trail.
Okay. Who marks these, Paul?
Chris McCarron was a member of the Conservation Commission. She's now on forestry, and she's our trail manager. She GPS is the trails and creates the trail maps, and then she gets groups of volunteers to come out and put up all these signs. And we started off years ago. In fact, you'll see some right here. See how this tree is marked with a blue spot? We
yes.
started out
okay. Yes.
making these templates and then going in the woods with spray cans.
Watch yourself.
Spray painting symbols on the
okay.
trees.
Yes.
And then it turns out they don't last that long.
No.
So she found a source where you can get these nice plastic, various shaped little trail markers. So we use the funds from our timber harvest to buy the trail markers. And then she goes out and nails them to the trees with a long nail so the tree can grow. And they last much longer. And then you can have arrows and you can have triangles and diamonds and circles and
okay.
you know, do a lot more trail.
You buy the shapes or do you cut them out?
She orders them already cut.
Okay.
So you order the shape and the color.
Now, Chris is a volunteer.
Oh, yeah. They're all volunteers.
All volunteers. So if anybody's watching and they have an interest in getting involved so they get outdoors a little bit, they don't like to make commitments to go to all kinds of nighttime meetings, there's certainly ample opportunity for trail maintenance and trail volunteers, I'm assuming.
Absolutely. They can just send their information to me or to the town hall, and then what will happen is when we do trail cleanups, we'll send an email to them, and if they're available that day, they can come and join us, or they can get involved as much or as little as they'd like.
All right, now here we are. This obviously depends on the time of the year, but is this skunk cabbage I'm looking at that's growing down in here?
It is exactly skunk cabbage, and it's skunk cabbage for the obvious reason that it stinks.
Oh, that's disgusting.
Yeah, it's not really good. You don't want to spread that all over yourself before you go out to dinner. And this is a classic, just a little wetland. We try to be as unobtrusive as possible. Just, you know, lay a few stones and walk your way across.
Okay.
And this stone wall, it's a classic example of New England stone walls. That's the dividing line between the 110 acres, which is on the other side of the wall that we bought from the Merriam family, and this was the 37-acre parcel we bought from the Cutter family.
Okay.
And I might mention that this is one of the large wetlands that's formed by a beaver dam. There's a huge beaver house out here. And last time I was here, we saw two Canadian geese and a lot of turtles. So we'll see what luck we have today.
Lead the way, please.
Okay.
It's pretty quiet out here at the moment.
It's quiet out here, yeah.
If I want to see a lot of bird activity, I assume I would come to this wetland somewhere closer to dawn.
Yes, or dusk.
Or dusk.
Yeah, okay. But dawn is probably good, and of course at this time of year, that's about 5 a.m, so you gotta wanna come here early. But if you came early and just sat yourself down, be amazed at how much activity you'd see around you.
Watch yourself.
Yeah, I will.
Here's a good look at the main beaver house.
Oh, okay. I see it right there in the middle.
It's just huge. And keep in mind now that the entrance to that is underwater. So the beavers swim underwater, enter the house, and then come above the water line in the beaver house. So they're protected from anything like coyotes or anything from getting at them, because whatever predator they would have to swim underwater. And
okay, gonna be very difficult getting out there.
Right, and what happens is these guys they build a dam, this has been here for years, and then whatever family of beavers is in essence owning this pond, when they have young ones, they kick them out. And those beavers typically go upstream, build another dam, form another pond, build their own house.
Okay.
And it happens again. And we're gonna see three levels of that in this conservation area. This is the lowest beaver dam. After this one, it goes through a little stream, goes under Sherman Road, and then goes under Mammoth Road and connects to Beaver Brook. I don't believe there's any other beaver houses downstream from here.
Okay.
But there's at least two more that form the other large wetland.
Oftentimes, as you're walking through these woods, and it's true anytime anybody goes for a walk in the woods, is a lot of the local wildlife hears you coming because you sound like a herd of buffalo, whether you want to or not.
Right.
And but you can always hear the birds. So it's fun to identify some of them but just by their sound.
I'm very poor at that. I know very little about bird call.
Well, I'm learning a little. We have a lot of experts in town who know a ton about birds.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. So this takes you right down near the water, doesn't it?
That's
almost.
That's the whole idea. We try
okay.
to stay a safe distance so you can see things.
Yep.
And you're in the uplands, but get you to where there's something to see. Now, I don't know if you want to go down here. There's an old beaver house at the end of this. This is just the dead end little.
All right, why don't
stretch.
We stick to the main trail, but.
Because you got a picture of it.
All right, but there's places to explore.
Yeah, you can go off the trail.
I mean, you can walk down there and get closer to the water. I was here maybe last fall sometime or late last summer with one of our daughters and a couple of grandchildren, and we saw a deer right over in here, and we saw it again when we came back. It was trying to hide and it was doing a very good job, but we still were able to spot it, which was fun.
I have to say, I've never come across a deer on this trail, in this conservation area. That's pretty good sighting.
So this is a typical sort of a New Hampshire trail. Rocky, roots, got to keep your eyes open.
Absolutely.
Got to keep your eyes open.
All of our conservation areas. We try not to make them any more difficult than this, but they tend not to get any easier either.
good news is if you come here with really small kids who can walk a little ways, you can walk a little ways, enjoy the water, look at the turtles, and turn around and go back if it gets too much.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think little kids would be fine with this. I think it's us old kids that have the most trouble.
The little kids, you have to slow down.
Yeah, little kids, you have to keep up.
Slow down.
Now, one thing you might notice here is if you pan the woods, you'll see this has not been harvested. This is one of the few conservation areas we have not harvested, and we've had discussions at the Forestry Committee about keeping this as old growth. This is about as old as it gets in this part of New Hampshire because it was all cleared back in the late 1800s. This was probably all sheep land, and that's why all these stone walls were built.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was going to say, when we cross the bridge up here a little ways, we'll go to the cutter portion of the property, which has been logged. We can pan again and you'll see it's more open, which has its advantages for wildlife, as does this.
And the Conservation Commission and Forestry Committee manage the forests with a professional forester.
Absolutely, yes. We don't just hire a logger and say, go to town and
don't
cut
just
the
come
trees.
In and cut. Okay.
No, we hire a professional forester. He writes a forest management plan on a parcel. In fact, we're meeting him on Monday at the Kirby Iverstown Forest because he just did a forest management plan there. Then we present the plan to the Board of Selectmen. We get the approval to harvest the timber on that parcel, and we put it out to bid. Loggers bid on it. We pick the highest bidder because they're paying us. So we get the most money from the highest bidder.
Okay.
And they only cut the trees that were marked by the forester. Every single tree that's going to be cut is marked with a blue stripe.
That's astounding.
And those are the only trees they cut.
Yep.
So it's very well managed.
And the money goes where?
Money goes into the forestry fund. And then usually once a year we have a warrant article asking the voters if they will allow us to take money out of the forestry fund to build trails like this and buy trail markers and to build kiosks
and to buy signs and to do that sort of thing.
All that good stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
And I have to say they've been tremendously supportive. We've had 100% success with the warrant articles.
Good. Good. All right. Let's continue our walk.
One of the things that I think is important is when you are hiking, don't just look for the big stuff. It's not all about deer and bears and geese, but it's about the small stuff. Nature in the small can be magnificent. Look at that violet, just one single little flower, and it's right next to a very small jack in the pulpet.
Oh yes, okay. Oh, I see that. I see that. Oh yeah. And this is wildflower season. Not sure when this is going to be shown, but we're walking in the spring.
In fact, look, we're just
there's a bunch of them here.
In a field of jack in the pulpits.
Oh yeah.
There's a much larger one, but even that isn't very big compared to how big they do get. If you come across a purple one, and we'll look for these, they're trillium.
Trillium. Okay.
It's called trillium.
These other sort of single-leafed guys that carpet the floor, I don't know the scientific name, but they're called false lily of the valley.
Yeah, they're called a Canadian lily of the valley.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, that's a native species, and it's, like you said, it looks like the hybrid lily of the valley is much bigger and has a more pronounced white flower.
Yes.
But this is a Canadian lily of the valley.
Oh, here you go. And I should know the name of this. What's that one?
I call it a star flower, but I don't know if that's the official name. But again, once you start looking, isn't it amazing?
There's a lot here.
You know, 50 feet, and now all of a sudden you're looking at flowers instead of looking for birds and animals, which are also interesting.
Now, you can still hear as you walk through here some of the traffic from Sherburn Road, and I know that I've gone walking in the Gumpus Conservation Area. You can't hear anything.
Absolutely.
You may as well be in the White Mountains.
Absolutely. Well, of course, the The beauty of that conservation area is it abuts the Musquash conservation area. Musquash is some 400 odd acres.
In Hudson.
In Hudson, and the Gumpus Pond is 155, so you've got a huge open space with no roads. And even here, very soon, we won't hear Sherburn Road anymore.
I never see these stone walls without thinking of the enormous amount of work that went into building those things.
It's mind-boggling.
It is mind-boggling.
And to think they're still standing.
Yep. Now, I'm standing here looking at a yellow blaze on that. Did we switch trails here somewhere along the line?
We did. The blue trail came onto the yellow trail just back here a short ways.
Okay.
The two forked.
Okay.
So you're absolutely right.
Okay, yeah, I'm following you. I wasn't watching the blazes.
Yeah, I know.
But the blazes are frequent enough that no one's going to get off the trail.
No, and the trail is so used.
One apparently.
One of the advantages of this, plus we just had a cleanup Sunday 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
So we picked all the dead branches off.
Oh, look at that. Wow. Wow, look at that. That is quite a view, isn't it?
This is the biggest wetland on the property, and we're going to go down and see the dam that forms it. It's a great example of a beaver dam, and it's being actively maintained. Amazing how much water pressure it must hold back.
Oh, I see a beautiful bridge down there. That was not built by the forest elves, I'm going to guess, Paul.
No, no, I had a hand in doing that along with some other volunteers. The trail used to go down there and go to the bridge, but the beavers built the dam up about a foot and flooded this, so we rerouted the trail around here. That's why there's red symbols on the tree.
Okay. I can remember coming here one time years ago when you had to walk across the beaver dam.
Absolutely.
It was the only way to get there. It was somewhat risky, entertaining, but risky.
Yeah, it wasn't something you wanted to advertise for everyone.
No.
So we're veering off the yellow trail onto the red trail. This is going to bring us to what's called the boulder loop in that field.
Okay. Wow, this is a nice bridge.
Here's a good example of how the beavers have raised the elevation. That's got to be
20
feet of water being held back there, and it's hardly a drop is leaking through. It's just remarkable. And there, of course, is the beaver house. Oh, and there's a Canadian goose.
Okay.
Standing on that point. Now,
okay.
There's a good chance that there's the mate to that goose is on egg somewhere very close to that Canadian goose, because at this time of year, it's almost a guarantee there's a pair and they're on eggs. We're not likely to see her or him because he's going to be in the brush just enough that you can't see him, but close enough to the water to escape quickly.
So this bridge, not to beat this to death, but the money that paid for this came from the conservation fund, most likely.
The forestry.
Harvesting.
Timber harvest.
Okay.
Monies.
So the money from the timber harvest, among other things, helps to pay for projects like this bridge.
That's right. No labor, because we try to get the labor volunteer.
Okay.
Sweat equity.
Okay.
And but the materials are paid for by that. And we do try to follow the rules. I actually was the one who applied to the state and sent pictures of this and described the way the bridge would be constructed. And you notice here we just have a wooden footing. We didn't dig into the wetland
or pour
any concrete or anything. We didn't even put these into the mud. We just set this.
Oh, it's just sitting on the bottom of the pond.
Just sitting on the bottom.
Okay.
That was it. And then we tried to stand to this old stone wall. Here again, where we've been meandering between the Merriam property and the Cutter property, and here's that same stone wall, and we're going back onto the Cutter property.
Okay.
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 So here you can see we're on the red trail, and the shape has changed also. It's so if somebody's colorblind, they should be able to follow these by the symbol.
And the trick usually in following these blazes is to keep your eye on the next one. So if you're not sure where you're going, always look for that next one, which should be in sight, and it's right there.
And then, of course, the trail's pretty clearly marked.
Yes. Well, as you said before, this trail's been used enough. It would be hard to think of it as anything other than the trail.
Right. Not all our conservation lands are that well used. Here's a high bush blueberry.
Okay.
And it's in bloom. And each one of these.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Camera.
Yep.
Each one of these little white flowers.
Yep.
Will become a blueberry if it's pollinated by the bees. Hopefully, it will be. And they tend to grow in low areas and wet areas, and that's predominantly what the brush is in here. Is all these high bush blueberries.
And again, this has not been forested.
This piece has not. We're about to go into a piece that has. Here's something that I actually like. The trail, the secondary trail cuts off, two private property signs. Those are abutters who use these trails so frequently. They have worn their own path to these trails.
Good, okay.
And they're just, good. In a polite way saying, hey, this is not the town land anymore.
Okay, yeah.
And you'll find a tremendous number of abutters who have their own little trails, even if some of them own snowmobiles. And if this is not a snowmobile trail, but if it happened to be a snowmobile trail, they'll have a little snowmobile path onto the main trail, and they'll have a little sign that says, you know, entering private property.
The critical thing is that everybody respects the fact that this is a butter's property.
That's the key.
Not town land, and you haven't got a right to go on it, especially if someone has posted it as private property.
Exactly. Remember this bridge, Bill? You helped build it at the Little Island Pond Conservation Area.
Oh my goodness!
And then when we had it harvested, they made a passage for the log trucks, which everybody used, so we didn't need this bridge. So we moved it from there to here.
Oh geez, I can't say I remember the specific bridge, but I remember building it, helping to build it. How about that? I think it's apparent from walking along too, and I'm delighted to be able to say this, it appears that the folks who walk back here respect the land. I don't see trash.
Yeah, you're right.
You know, which you do.
Occasional bit of trash, but it's not, you don't find much. Most people are respectful. Simply carry in, carry out. Now we're getting into the portion that's been logged. It was logged several years ago, and you'll start to see that it's more open, and there's stumps from where the trees were taken out.
Okay, so a cut-off stump just like this one is a sign that it's been logged.
Absolutely.
Not trying to state the obvious, but...
And what we're on now is actually what's left of a skitter trail. We tend to put our... It's simple to put your hiking trails where the skitters drag the logs, because now they've knocked all the brush down. And so you see that this is a fairly wide, clear area. Obviously the brush is growing.
Okay.
We're walking down the middle of it.
And some of the browse that's popping out of these cut off tree trunks is good for the deer, as I understand it.
Absolutely.
They like to eat that. So part of when you cut, not a pine obviously, but the hardwood trees, they send up all these sprouts.
And you also get a lot of berries. Blackberries and black raspberries tend to grow, and we're going to see a large spot of them coming up here.
Because the sun gets in now, too.
Exactly.
When will this be harvested again?
There's another good example.
Oh.
Some of the things you see, these are this is a caterpillar nest. God knows what kind of butterfly or moth it's going to turn out to be, but they're kind of all sleeping. It isn't warm enough. Notice that the leaves on this.
They're gone.
All been eaten.
Yep.
And the branch next to it is all leafed out.
Ah, yes.
So the caterpillars have been having lunch.
Those are the eastern tent caterpillars.
Is that what they are?
They are. We don't see too many of those. What you get a lot of in town, not so much last year, but I've seen them before, is what they call fall webworm. And a fall webworm looks exactly, builds the same kind of a tent, eats the leaves. As I understand, it doesn't do a lot of damage because it's eating the leaves in September. And so the tree doesn't lose much from it. These can be more damaging. They're natural. There's not much you can do about them.
Do you know if they, are they a moth or a butterfly?
I don't know what they turn into.
Okay.
And I don't want to stick around to find out. Okay.
Another example of nature in the small, just the beautiful,
I don't know what those are either.
They sure are beautiful.
I'm sure there's someone who will be watching this program who will say,
yeah, how can you guys such you know something about the woods?
How can you be, how can you be so dumb? No.
Like
how about that? We have no idea what they are, but we know what they're not.
There you go.
Actually, for a skidder trail, this is in pretty good shape.
Not bad at all, is it? You didn't get a good picture of the blueberries. There's a good picture of some future blueberries.
When was this cut?
And you can see they're all in here, this whole area. It would be great in August.
And so the blueberries are one of the species that thrive when they can get a little bit of sun in here.
Absolutely. And when was it cut?
When was it cut? Was it 4 years ago, five?
I'd say more. I think maybe, might even be coming on 10 years now.
Okay.
It's been a while.
Okay.
Maybe eight, something like that. Because it's, you can see it, all the slash is pretty much rotted and there's no damage left from the skidders. And a lot of the, you look in there, the early succession stuff, which is tends to be the birch trees, the black and white birch are all up.
They're tall.
No, they're 10 feet high.
Yep.
So I think it's probably been 8 years. Some of the damage you don't like to see, but you know, a log runs against that one.
Okay, a little bit of that happens.
Here's the kind of these are black raspberries that are
Okay,
and that's obviously a great natural food for the animals. Those will be ready in about second week of July.
And if anyone's watching this, they better get here on time because the blue jays and the other birds will will clean them off. So, relative to Sherburne Road, where are we at the moment?
We're essentially paralleling Sherburne Road.
Are we headed?
We're headed towards Mammoth.
Towards Mammoth.
And almost directly paralleling Sherburne.
Okay.
In, less than a quarter of a mile from Sherburne Road.
Okay.
But enough that you don't hear the traffic.
Not really, no.
You hear the wind through the trees.
Yeah.
Just a little bit of a hill and enough trees between us and Sherburne Road. It doesn't take away the natural beauty. You know, a good example of all that early succession habitat.
Okay.
Comes in when you do clear cut. And if you, you know, if you pan back there, you see the trees are not nearly as dense.
That's true. There's a lot of room for sunlight to come in.
Yep.
To open up for the next generation of trees.
And yet they leave these mammoth trees. Look at the size of that oak.
Now, why would they leave a tree like that, Paul?
Because that is this. You know, the harvesting isn't just done for the lumber. It's wood, wildlife, water and recreation.
Okay.
So that would be left for wildlife because an oak tree that size can produce, the mass can produce up to 100 pounds of acorns in a good year.
Okay.
So there's a lot of feed.
So there's a lot of feed and future oak trees,
and
obviously.
Future oak trees is right,
okay,
as well. And plus it's potentially nesting spot for hawks or whatever, and it looks good. They're trying to leave it for us also. They don't want us to walk through a forest that's been just denuded of all the good trees.
Sure, as I look around, there's really quite a few large trees still standing.
Yeah, and the idea is that in 15 years when we harvest it again, there'll be some revenue for the town, and so it's an ongoing source of revenue if managed well.
We're still following the red trail I see from the blazes.
Yes.
Now, what are these logs doing here on the ground or in the wetland?
This was a skitter bridge. They laid the logs down to allow the water to still pass through, but allow the skitter to drag the logs over it.
Okay.
Now here you can see activity from the beavers. Obviously a beaver has built the dam, flooded this area, and it's killed all these trees many years ago, because you can see they're all dead and most of them have lost their bark. I'm looking out in the distance there. And eventually that could become a heron rookery, because once the tops of those trees start falling off, the herons tend to make nests in there and raise their young.
And you can see this as you drive along Sherburne Road.
You can.
Right? As you head toward Hudson, it's on the right-hand side.
Yes.
There's a big area of dead trees.
That's right. I don't know how many times we want to stop, but we'll keep stopping.
Oh, keep
this
stopping.
This is the time of year to eat fiddlehead fern.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody's heard of it. I can't say I've actually done it.
I never had them. I know they can be, you can buy them in the grocery stores.
You can buy them in the grocery stores. Just pick them and steam them, I guess, and eat them.
We'll pass this up.
Yeah,
a roadside snack. Probably not real delicious if you eat them raw. That's my guess.
Okay, here we'll take a little spur onto one of the boulder loops.
All right, and that's because we know that the arrow's pointing to the right.
And, yeah.
Okay, and are there two red blazes on this other tree over here? Paul, two blocks. It looks like two blocks there and two blocks here. I don't know if
that's... To be honest, I'm not sure what he's trying to tell us, because that's part of the red trail, and this is a red trail loop.
Okay.
It comes back on the main path. So you can see what he's bringing us.
Wow.
There.
I've never been on this part of... this parcel at all.
Plot, and you have a nice view of, there's a big beaver house in there where all those dead trees are.
So is this the rocks that you gave a name to before?
Yeah, these are called glacial erratics.
Glacial erratics.
Meaning that they've been just sort of randomly deposited by the glacier. And there's no sort of rhyme or reason to it other than the glacier just stopped moving them at this point.
And
this would be a spot. You talked about coming out early to do bird watching.
Yes.
You come out to a spot like this, sit down with your cup of coffee at about 5 in the morning, and just be quiet, and the woods would be just ablaze with sound, if that makes any sense.
It does. And there's a hemlock. I haven't seen too many hemlock trees here.
These are hemlocks. There was a section of hemlocks in that area that they have to take out because of that woolly adelgid.
Okay.
But apparently they didn't find it in these, so they left these. It's one of my favorite trees. I just think it has such a soft, airy...
They're spectacular trees.
They're beautiful.
Now the trick for me is to get down here without sliding all the way down. Now this is a little tougher here. It's a little up and down. I'm thinking of folks who might be considering where to go. The rocks are beautiful, but that's a little bit up and down back there. Oh, this is very rocky, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is why they call it the granite state, right? It's just this.
Wow. But they still came and cut back in here.
They did, yeah.
I'm a little surprised by that.
Right out of here, because there must be enough topsoil for those trees to have done well. As you can see, the pines that are growing here look pretty healthy. Now, now that we're up on a hill, and we're a little closer to Sherburne Road, you get a little of the road traffic.
You can hear the traffic.
Yeah.
I see the sides of the rock up here are covered with what we used to call rock tripe, I think it is.
I don't know.
And I know when I was with the...
These
sort of leafy things up here.
Yeah, I see that.
When I was with the scouts, theoretically, they used to tell us you could in a pinch, you could boil the stuff and eat it. Now, I never tried that, and I'm not going to.
It must be a fungus.
I don't know. No one watching or listening should attempt to eat it unless they know it's safe.
I suspect the great majority of what is out here we could eat. There's just some small percentage that would not go well.
It's a very interesting rock field, sort of scattered, as you said, randomly. Now, can I stop you for a second? So there's a seven on here. What's the seven for, Paul? Do you know what that seven's for?
I do not.
All right, no big deal.
I don't know if Chris is trying to. We're being asked by the fire department and the police department to provide them with trails so that if somebody calls 911, I'm in the Merriam Conservation and I'm lost, there's some way that
I need
they
help.
Could say, you know, or okay. They say, hey, there's a fire in the woods. So we're trying to do things that will allow us to identify them. And I don't know
this if might
Chris
be part
is
of that.
Thinking that we'll call this trail number 7 instead
okay.
of the red loop.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
But that looks like a new.
It looks very new.
And
yep.
It's the kind of thing she's been buying, but I should have an answer.
All right. No, no.
So here's when the trail veers. There's the main trail, the
okay.
red rectangles, and then okay. there's the double.
Here's
red.
The two red over red.
Interesting boulder field. And then we'll come out to the big field that we cleared and we cut annually.
Oh, look at this. This is even more boulders.
I find that interesting. Look at the balancing act that rock is performing.
It looks a little precarious there.
Isn't that something? It's really quite
That's
interesting.
Very interesting. You can see cracks where the frost and the winters are eating away at some of these rocks, too. Places where things have chipped off.
So far this morning, we haven't done too well with wildlife.
Now, is that the field that was also going to be used for the rabbits?
No.
Okay.
The eastern cottontail area is on the Gumpus Conservation
Area. Oh, okay.
And that
okay.
is also something we reclaimed out of the, you know, from a woodlot.
Yes.
Clear cut the trees and then took all the small growth down. So that wouldn't be like this in that it wouldn't be just grass. It would be early succession habitat.
Okay.
Because these rabbits need to be under all kinds of briar bushes and
need lots of protection
shrubs.
From hawks and
exactly.
things like that. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, it changes dramatically. So this field was here originally. I don't know what I mean by originally, but it was here. You didn't have to clear cut this whole thing and create the field, or did you?
It's a good question. It's a good spot to see the difference. This area was not field.
Okay.
In the recent past. So you
okay.
see the size of the trees.
Big
Even
trees.
Even though it's been logged.
Right.
The biggest trees have been taken out. There's still big trees. That is more representative of what this field had turned into. It was beyond early succession. It was almost a mature forest.
Okay.
But look at how dense it is. You could hardly walk through it. So we have to have a bulldozer skim off all these little trees.
Okay.
And basically, the loggers clear cut what there was of any value. Chipped a lot of it, used some for firewood,
yep.
and then what was left was bulldozed off into piles, so sort of piles of what were roots
okay.
that have since rotted.
Okay.
And then this was graded and seeded, and now every year we just have it cut late in the fall when all the ground birds are done nesting, and maintain it like this.
So to get back to something you had talked about earlier, the purpose for creating this is specifically to create habitat for certain kinds of animals.
Absolutely.
And birds and mammals.
That's it. That's it. Not every animal wants to live in the deep woods. In fact, the boundaries between two different types of habitat are where most animals live.
All along that edge.
All along
the
edge.
Edges.
They'll be nesting in the edge,
okay.
but they'll come out into the field to eat bugs or to eat worms or whatever. And they have protection by going into the wooded area from hawks and predators. So unfortunately, we don't see anything out here this morning, but...
We scared everything off by tromping through the woods. Now, is that another one over there?
Am I looking at another field?
Part
of the same field.
Okay.
That's right. Yeah, if you come down this end, there's a crossing through this wetland.
Okay.
We didn't clear too close to the wetland, obviously. Came across the wetland further up and then clear that side of the field.
Now, how do I know when I get to a point where I'm not in the town land anymore? Do I know that?
There you would need the map, because when you get to a field, we haven't got a way of marking a trail, so...
No trail, but if I kept on going, sooner or later I'm going to come to someone's yard, am I not?
You bet. You are. You're going to come to it right at that stone wall.
Okay.
And other than if you had the trail map that would show where the park ended, you wouldn't know.
Okay. But if you're following the marked trails, then
the
except for the
end,
here...
And you'd know...
You're not where you belong, probably.
Right. Yeah, because you wouldn't find any trails beyond here. You'd have to... climb over the stone wall and bushwhack.
Okay, and can I get those trail maps online someplace?
Yes, if you go to Pelham Recreation, and I think it's Pelham Conservation and Recreation Lands. If you go to the Pelham website,
you'll find it.
You'll find it. Pelham Conservation and Recreation Lands. You click on that, you get a map of the town, and all the town parcels are in green. If you click on the parcel, then you'll get some a list of the things you can and can't do. And it'll have a little sign there that'll say printable trail map, if there is one.
Okay.
We haven't done them for all parks yet.
Okay.
And then when you click on that, you can get a nice printable trail map and then bring it out with you.
Terrific. Now, is this is a skitter trail on its own. This is pretty wide.
This is the original farm trail to get to that field.
Oh, okay.
This trail would have brought you back to the Merriam farm at the corner of Sherman and Mammoth.
So this was the farmer's road.
That's right. Yeah, we did not create this trail. We used it for skidding, but it was here before.
It is amazing as you walk through here at all the new tree growth. I mean, you've been pointing it out all along, but it's just getting very thick.
Well, we're out at a perfect time of year, right? The leaves are all just coming out and they're soft and lime green. It's beautiful. Now, unfortunately, the clouds have moved in. It's sunny, but...
Now, you talk about uses. How about cross-country skiing in the winter? People cross-country in here, do they?
Cross-country,
snowshoeing.
One of the things we're struggling with is how we manage the parking areas in the winter, because right now we don't plow them. We don't spend the money to plow the parking areas. So the people who tend to use them tend to be abutters.
Okay.
So, for example, I abut the a snowmobile trail that comes right through my property, actually. So I'm lucky. I can get on the snowmobile trail
and
be parked in my garage.
Yes. All right. But
if you're not that lucky, then you're in a little bit of a pickle. There's one access point, which is at Veterans Park. The Snowmobile Club has, I believe, worked with Don Foss and perhaps with you, with the Board of Selectmen. They do plow a U-shaped area at Veterans, and there's room to pull in with snowmobile trailers and get access to the snowmobile trails there. Obviously, you could cross-country ski or snowshoe there as well. And we're trying to work a couple other spots in town where we might, like the cost of the conservation area is another one.
That's off Dutton Road,
We're working on putting a bigger parking lot in there and maybe plowing that in the winter, but it hasn't happened yet.
Does Costa Conservation Area have marked trails yet, Paul?
It does, but I don't believe we have a trail map for that yet.
Okay.
And we had it harvested and we cleaned up after the harvest, but I don't think Chris has marked all the trails.
Okay.
So, work in progress.
People watching who are thinking, I want to help, That's a good place.
That would be a good place. Two others that are, I believe we have trail maps for and that are well marked are the Kirby Ivers one, which is, has a parking lot.
Off Windham Road?
Yep, just north of the transfer station. And the other one is Peabody Town Forest.
Okay.
It used to be Old Lawrence,
and I forget the new name for it.
Yeah, I do too, but it's Briarwood.
Briarwood. Okay. Thank you.
And that's off Atwood.
Okay.
That also has a parking area and a sign and a kiosk and a number of trails.
Now, I just heard, if it does it again, a great western great crested flycatcher. Over there, it's an ugly sounding bird. It goes, reep, reep. That wasn't it. Reep, reep, reep.
Now while we're listening for that tree is obviously a woodpecker house. And that may be the reason why they didn't cut that tree. Look at how many.
Where am I? Oh, I see. On the left.
I see 1, 2, 3, 4, five. I count 6 holes. Now, I don't know how many are active, but I think the lowest one and the highest one both look active.
How about that? Yeah, they're going to have to leave dead trees. Snags.
Snags, absolutely.
Snags.
Yeah, and that one's doing a lot of work.
This is a beautiful wetland. I want to call it a pond, a lake almost. Wow.
We were talking... just last week when we were hiking this, that we probably can't do this for legal reasons. I hate when you can't do something for legal reasons, but wouldn't it be nice to have a canoe here with a couple of paddles?
It would.
And people could come and just paddle around and put the canoe back.
Enjoy yourself. Yeah, I know.
You know, what happens when some kid falls out and drowns?
Yeah.
Right? And so then it's, oh, who put that canoe there?
Or the canoe's gone all of a sudden and nobody knows where it went.
The least of my worries.
It's a little hard to get one out of here.
Yeah, you'd have to really want to do some, steal it. But
yeah,
I know I would use it.
But there's no prohibition if someone wanted to portage.
There is not.
They could
portage a kayak in and portage it out. It's only a 15-minute walk.
We're not that far from the parking lot down to this wetland. Okay. What you don't have is much of a good dry area to launch from. Whoever is using it would have to be willing to get down in the muck a little bit. Still following the yellow trail. Oh, is this a different bridge?
Yes, it is.
Wow.
This is actually another place.
I don't know what that is.
See whether those were mallards or wood ducks.
Okay.
There's a pair of ducks.
Okay. They didn't like us being within 200 feet of them, 500 feet of them.
So you mentioned earlier about crossing the beaver dam before we had the bridge.
Well, yes.
Where we used to walk that beaver.
Oh, geez. I mean, it's fun to do that, but if we're inviting people to take the family and go for a walk, that's a little bit more difficult.
It sure is.
Oh, this is perfect.
Here's another case where the beavers go upstream, build a dam, flood another area. The folks who grew up here, the Merriams, called that Sun Valley.
Sun Valley.
That open area. I guess it was a field at one time.
Okay. But it certainly isn't now.
Not today. It's not a field.
And
though,
you know, the funny thing is, we've been in a long dry period.
Yeah.
I mean, this is pretty a good deal of water considering... It's been dry for quite a while.
It has. In fact, given all the snow we had this winter, it's amazing. that it's so dry so early.
Well, I agree. I assume this is snow melt. I don't know what else it could be. I don't know.
Yeah, there's a couple of streams that come down off the hillside that feed okay. us, but as you can see, there's not a lot of flow, almost nothing coming.
It just sits here. Yeah.
Just sits here. So this is a reasonable point to turn around. If we were to continue, the yellow trail follows the water.
Okay.
And then it cuts uphill. And
okay.
And it goes uphill past what we call Phoebe Rock and then picks up a main snowmobile trail, and you can then loop back to the car. But instead, we'll go back this way. We'll take the yellow trail back to the parking lot.
And I see a lot of water lilies starting to emerge here. I don't know if this is a particular wet area, but I remember being at one in the last year or two. It was just a sea of white flowers at some point in the summer.
Absolutely. When we were building that other bridge, in fact, one of the people that was helping was so enamored with all the beautiful flowers, he came back with his wife after.
Oh, good.
The next day, brought her back, said, you have to see the water lilies.
It's amazing to see them.
They're gorgeous.
Tens of thousands of flowers.
Yeah, and they're large. They're,
yes, they are.
They're big white flowers.
Okay, back we go. I'll let you lead the way.
I had the suspicion that if we brought the binoculars, we wouldn't need them, and of course, if you don't bring them.
if you don't bring them, then it's like, oh.
Yourself, so. Oh, a great blue heron.
Where is it?
Okay. Probably not going to get them. It's going to be difficult to get them.
Yeah, I see him. He's on the right of that habit.
Yes, that's right. He's at the point.
He's looking for fish.
You betcha.
Or frogs.
Yeah. This thing won't go digital, but I'll zoom in a little bit.
Look, at now you got a nice side profile of his head.
Stop.
We have covered a lot of stuff. Somebody watches this and takes notes. Well, the interesting thing, I'm going to guess that conservation and forestry would love to hear of any discoveries that anybody made who came back here and make an interesting discovery or see an unusual bird.
You bet.
Let members of the Conservation Commission know about it.
Yeah.
So some of the things you can't do on this land is no motorized wheeled vehicles.
Correct.
No campfires.
Correct.
No overnight camping.
Right. It is open to hunting.
It's open to hunting.
Following, of course, all the hunting rules and having a license in the right season and all those things.
And when I've walked here, if it's anywhere near hunting season, I always wear orange. Some people think that we should post these lands for no hunting, but the truth is, and I'm not a hunter, but the deer population can get out of control.
That's one point. The other one that I would make is that there are already far too few people that get out and then take advantage of our open space. And why should we be closing it off to the few who want to do that?
Yeah.
And sure, if you're out here in the fall, you should wear orange and be careful. But hunting season's only a few weeks of the year.
It's not very long.
Hikers have it the whole year.
That's right.
And by the way, lady slippers.
Oh.
I just found them.
Oh, yes.
Another example of nature in the small. Is that a magnificent?
That's spectacular.
Just an amazing flower.
And that's a protected species.
That is protected. Yeah, please don't transplant that. They typically won't grow where you want them to grow, like in your front yard.
I tried it once many years ago before I was aware of their protective status.
Yeah, they have a very...
They don't grow.
No, there's something about the environment they need. It's pretty...
I have read, and someone can correct me, they require the presence of a certain fungus in the soil.
Oh, really?
And if it's not there, they're not growing.
Interesting.
So, hear that? I think that's the rose-breasted grosbeak.
Oh.
That's the rose-breasted grosbeak.
I saw one of those last Tuesday when we hiked. That's a magnificent bird.
It is a magnificent bird. They look like they don't belong here. Oops, somebody's up there. I can hear it.
Just wind.
Yeah, that's a rose-breasted grosbeak. It sounds like a robin, but it's... This kind of goes on and on.
It's white and black with that rose colored chest. It's a, and the, of course the grosbeak, the big, huge orange.
They're spectacular birds.
It is. I had never seen one in the wild till the other day. When I saw it, I was like, oh my God, look at that.
Yeah, yeah, they're amazing. I remember going for a walk in Gumpus and seeing three or four rose-breasted grosbeaks a couple of years ago and being amazed, because if we see one in our backyard feeder, that's considered quite an accomplishment.
It was Gumpus where I saw it.
Was it? They're attracted there for some reason. I don't know why. Of course, it's very thick woods.
Pretty squeezed in.
Oh, yeah. What do you see?
Oh, there's all kinds of bark missing on that tree over
there. Oh, yeah. Yep.
That's probably a woodpecker. Just, I'm guessing woodpecker.
Yeah,
on that
I
one.
Think that's all it is. It's rotting in the wood, but there's even a branch taken off that's completely scun clean. That thing must be full of bugs.
Well, Jim, thank you very much for doing this one. I know this is one of the most difficult we've done. The most difficult. And Paul, thank you.
It's not over yet.
I know.
No,
it's just starting. But the whole idea is to get people to use these places. So with any luck, some people will say, hey, let's go there. Well, thank you very much for coming along on our walk. And Paul, thank you very much, especially for your guidance, for your explanation of the trails and the topography and everything. I appreciate your spending the time.
You're welcome. I learned something, too. I always do. I learned about bird calls. I'm deficient on bird calls.
What little I know about bird calls.
Well, it's about 100 times more than me, so that was great. I enjoyed it. Thanks for the invitation.
Well, the whole idea here, and for people watching this, is get out and use these lands that Paul and members of the Conservation Commission have worked so hard to acquire on your behalf, and enjoy them. So thanks for tuning in. It's been a real pleasure. Cut.